guys, how's it going? It's Ben back with another video, and today we got a really cool one for you guys. We're exploring this amazing garage here in Auckland with a car collector, Grant Baker. So this is his garage. He's got quite a few Ferraris and a few other really special cars here. So he's gonna give us a little tour today of the place, tell us about the cars, show us around. And yeah, there's just a bunch of really cool and interesting cars and probably a few cool stories around here as well, so let's get into it.
Hi Ben, welcome to the man cave. Got a few things to show you today. So we'll start off with the Porsche 911 GT3 RS. This is kind of a special car, mainly because of every option box up in the car. It's got magnesium wheels, got the lighting on the side, it's got the carbon fibre roof, quite lightweight. And in New Zealand, there's only two of these ever come in, so I was sort of pretty lucky to have it. First day I bought it, I took it down to Hampton Downs, which is a local racetrack in Auckland, and drove it straight down there. That was the running in period. Drove it around the track for a day and drove it back here. Hasn't done too much since. Fantastic track car, Porsche. We used to race these years ago, back in the early 2000s, and they're just absolutely bulletproof. You can drive them to the track, drive them hard all day, and they just keep going. It's got the full racing buckets, but started off, the first car's a Mark 1 Cortina, and kind of gradually got more budget built up from there, but I had a long kind of love affair with Porsches, so I've got this one now. We've got a Cayenne, but I used to have a Carrera GT, V10 Carrera GT, plus heaps of different 911s, 911 turbos, GT3s, that sort of stuff. Anyway, moving right along to my new passion, which is not that new actually, it's been going for about 20 years, but my passion, which is really Ferrari. So the first car I'll show you here is the F12 TDF. So TDF stands for Tour de France, so that was a famous race in Europe. Going back in the late 50s, so there is an old 250 TDF car that you'll see pictures of, fantastic looking car, and this is kind of the modern version of it. So this one's painted in the launch colour, so it's triple layer yellow. So certain lights kind of looks different. It's inside now, it really looks better when it's outside. But the fantastic colour of the car, absolutely glows. One of the things I really like the way Ferrari do a stripe, you see a lot of cars with a stripe on them, like the Porsche, but it's a sticker. Whereas Ferrari painted all the stuff into the paint, so you can run your hand along here, it's completely smooth. So they paint it on, sand it down, put a clear coat on it and just make it mint. So it's kind of a very expensive stripe, but that's why, because it's so cool.
How much was the stripe, Grant?
The stripe is like, I think it was like a 12 grand thing for a stripe. I've heard on some cars, like on McLaren Center and so on, you can pay like 100 grand for a stripe, so
wow.
It's kind of a bargain in that context. I'd like to think I talked Ferrari into doing this. It's got the painted on shields, and we went to the factory with my wife and kids when we bought this car back in, I think it was in 2014, and speccing it, and I said, hey, I really want that painted on shield, not like the ceramic shield they normally have on them. And I said, typical Italians, oh, it is impossible. But he was, well, why? Surely you can get a guy to paint it. It's what you used to have on the old race cars. And it took about 6 months of negotiating, and they finally said, oh, actually, we can do that. So I've seen a few of these with this painted on shield, but I just think it looks so cool because it's big and it's like the old 50s race cars. And because this is named after a 50s race, I thought it was pretty appropriate. And all the wheels on this car are, they're now known as TDF alloys. So they're pretty popular. A lot of people ordering new cars with alloys that look like this, and they're in the catalogue now is some TDF alloys, obviously carbon ceramic. I think that's an 8-piston caliper, so they pull it up pretty quick.
Yeah, I really like this car. Is pretty much just completely black carbon fibre and yellow. Little hints of the Ferrari red and green around, but
yeah.
It's really good.
Back in the old days, everyone used to think all Ferraris were red, but the popularity certainly was red. I mean, there's all sorts of colours nowadays, but the second most popular was yellow for Ferrari. And I think over time has been, because in modern, apparently that's the town colour of modern is yellow, so a lot of people like to order yellow cars.
Especially this colour on the sign, it just looks incredible, eh?
Yeah, I do like that. It's one of my favourites, as you'll see as we go along. But I thought it's worth looking under here. I always have to do this because...
Huge engine.
Yeah, it's a big engine. It's like over 6 litre V12. 800 horsepower, naturally aspirated. And it's like an absolute beast of a car. Like, it's very fast and very scary to drive. This carbon under here is about the price of a Toyota Corolla. So to make it worthwhile. Oh, probably the other thing in the engine bay is worth talking about is just how far back it is.
Yeah.
Although it's front engine, it's mid-engine car.
Yeah,
it's a front mid-engine. So the front of that engine is actually behind the front axle.
Yeah. Especially with how large the intakes are, it's just like, well, it's like, what, a metre and a half long, basically?
Yeah.
Crazy.
It's a big car.
Yeah. Do you feel like you're sitting at the very back of the car when you drive that? Because the hood's so long and then there's not really much behind you, right?
You do, you're more or less sitting in the middle of the car. I think the weight distribution is pretty much 50-50, you know, so I'm kind of used to driving that type of car. I like that style of car to drive, probably more than a mid-engine car, so
yeah.
The front engine rear-wheel drive type of things. It's a bit more hoony, you know,
so yeah.
More fun to drive.
Nice.
But speaking of hoony type cars, have anyone been watching the Ford versus Ferrari? So this is the Shelby Cobra. So this car is based on a British sports car called the AC that used to come out, I think, with a 4 or 6 cylinder engine. It's maybe a Bristol engine. And when the Americans were trying to take on Ferrari, they were trying to figure out, you know, what cars to build that could beat Ferrari. And that's Cal Shelby started off with these. And he decided, you know, small British chassis and I'll kind of shove an American V8 into it. So they started off with a 260 cubic inch V8 and went to a 289. And then to a 427 and 428. So this is a 427. But this is kind of your old school V8. So this is 7 litre V8. It's got twin poly carburetors on it. So I believe it's the same engine that was in the 1940s that won Le Mans. So yeah, produced about 450 horsepower. So power to weight ratio on this thing is huge because the car weighs 800 kilos. So, like compared to the TDF, the TDF's got 800 horsepower, but it also weighs kind of 1650, 1700 kilos. But this is very light and it's got hardly any brakes, it's got no traction control.
Yeah.
Very loose sort of car to drive. They made 150 of them, so.
Oh, wow.
Ever. So, it's quite a rare car. So, this is obviously a Ferrari Enzo. Years. It came out of Denmark and it was owned by an interesting guy there. He was some sort of inventor and he was quite a wealthy guy. He had his own private jet and he used to keep his car collection. He had a lot of cars, about 30 cars. He kept his car collection in his jet hangar because it was on the air side of the airport and you didn't have to pay tax there. The tax on cars in Denmark is like 300%.
Oh wow.
But because he couldn't take it on the road, it's got no miles on it. So this car is just like a brand new Enzo. And I think, you know, there might be one or two others in the world, but they only made 400 Enzos. Most of them would have been driven, you know, quite a lot. So this car's got 282 kilometers on it.
Wow.
So it's really rare. It's just like perfect condition. I'm the second owner of this car and the first owner never drove it. So stuff stayed with it. So it comes with some, I don't know why, but like it's got a spare accelerator pedal. So. Maybe because you're always mashing this to the floor, you need another one or something, I don't know. Came with these special gloves that are, you know, you have to do something. Piece and dish, like change a tyre, and you didn't get your hands dirty. Little code for the car, in case you lose your keys, you can get another one and stuff. But just quite rare to have that.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's nowhere. This is the total storage in the car, is this area here. So
yeah.
You're going to have a...
You can probably put your phone and maybe a sandwich in there.
So it came with this little book about the Enzo, and these sort of things are gold. You just can't normally get them. And, you know, a letter from Luca Montezemolo to the original owner.
Oh,
and
wow. It's actually like a...
Yeah, it's a real signature,
yeah. Wow.
Yeah. If you buy any of these really top-end cars, you always get a proper letter from the chairman of Ferrari.
Wow. I really like how this car looks when all the... Because the doors go up and the back goes up as well. It looks almost like a transformer when it's all up in the air.
It is a very cool car. I mean, just to look at it is my favorite car.
Yeah.
Trying to think, 2011, 2012, I had another one, a red one, which had about 6,000 Ks on it. And I did about 6,000 k's driving on it and kept it up in Europe for a long time, eventually brought it back here. But yeah, we toured all through Europe in it, and fantastic driving an Enzo and Ferrari, because basically it's not possible to get a ticket in a Ferrari in Italy. You go as fast as you like. So
oh, yeah?
Yeah, we cracked up kind of 300 k's on the road. Wow. Just fantastic drive. And these things are just better and better the faster you go. They're a bit clunky around town, but yeah, like today's standard is not that powerful. It's 660 horsepower V12, but it just sounds
I wouldn't be complaining.
No, it's quite
relatively
light.
Yeah, yeah.
1200 kilos. It's all made of carbon fiber.
Yeah.
And it's the first car Ferrari built with carbon ceramic brakes. So, yeah, that was very sort of revolutionary in kind of 2002 when these came out.
And the interior is quite modern for. It was quite modern for when it came out, and it still looks very modern.
Yes, it's nice.
Yeah.
That is a beautiful, comfortable too.
Yeah.
You just sit in there all day.
Yeah. Yeah, it looks very just comfortable and simple, eh?
You've got to kind of do this manually, but
yeah.
Just sneak around here and have a look in here while I've got it up. But it's just like looking at the back of a Formula One car or something.
Yeah.
You know, once again, it's mid-engine, but rear mid-engine, there's like
sideways
suspension.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah, and obviously these are the pumps that pump your shock absorbers to give you race mode or street mode or whatever.
Wow.
But you can see all the big exhaust headers coming out.
Yeah.
They're quite raw compared to something that comes out today. So
yeah.
I suppose it's pretty sophisticated for its day, but
yeah.
I have driven it about 20 kilometres.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, when I first got it, I drove it about 20 k's. I went out to lunch with some guys. I thought, well, hey, guy, I thought we'd go in this. And what happened? It rained on it. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's been hours and hours cleaning it up. Yeah, so that's the Enzo anyway, and it's named after Enzo Ferrari, the founder of Ferrari, so it's kind of always going to be special. So this is what they call that pista piloti. Piloti is driver or pilot in Italian. So they would only supply you one of these cars if you were in part of their racing program. So you're either racing a Challenger or obviously Formula One or something, but there's not many people. There's no official numbers on how many they made, but I have heard that they made 56 of them. So may or may not be right, but they won't have made many because there's not that many people in the racing programs.
Yeah.
And Ferrari typically has about 10% of their productions in right-hand drive. So you'd imagine there's probably only 5 or 6 right-hand drive ones in the world. So mechanically, this is the same as a normal Rodiac pista, but it's got a bunch of stuff that cosmetically different, a little bit in different aero and stuff. Ferrari won the World Endurance Championship in 2017, and I think the number of that car was number 51. But when you ordered this, you could either have number 51 on it, or you could have your own race number. So mine's 27, because a lot of the famous Ferrari drivers had that, but we had to have a 3-digit number, so it became 127. But all this here is the same thing. It's got that painted in stripe, the homage to the win the World Endurance Championship. And this has got some very cool things, like it's got carbon fiber wheels, which is like a ridiculously expensive extra. It's like $58,000 extra.
Wow.
So yeah, it's just nuts. But you just figure these things, I think I'm not going to sell it, so I might as well have it as right as it can ever be.
Yeah. And look at this, the carbon shining here, it just looks amazing.
Yeah, they're very light, so it keeps the
unsprung
weight of the car, makes it handle better and so on. And they've done heaps of the paint, they've followed the stripe right through, there's heaps of carbon on. And it's actually made by Ferrari's TaylorMade program. So TaylorMade in Ferrari is when you can go and you can design something that's not off the shelf. And,
Yeah,
so TaylorMade, exclusively for Piloti Ferrari. And it's got heaps of little detail in here. It's got
The
shifter's got the Italian flag. And if you look at the floor mat on there, it's got the Italian flag even kind of through the perforations in the floor mat. Yeah, and if you go around the side, the seats are like that too. But so they're just kind of cool little touches that nothing else has got. And then the aero treatment here is quite different to the normal pistol, so it's got a bit more scoop in there.
Oh, yeah.
And that spoiler. So
all this carbon fiber. Beautiful.
And the one thing they've really improved on these cars lately is the charging. So this is just a sort of little clip you put on the back of the car, like that's just
slots in there.
It's tricky, you had to open the door and put something under the dash. It was a real pain in the bum.
How often do you have to, because obviously, you know, they're very, you know, high performance and everything, like, do you have to start them up every few months or?
Yeah, theoretically. I mean, I think the only real problem is, you know, you might get a flat spot on the tyres, so trying to move around, and if you run up to warm, but I try not to get too much fuel in them because the fuel goes off.
So. Yeah. This is your race car right here?
This is it, yeah. So this is kind of it's a 488, the chassis built by Ferrari, but they give them to Michelotto to build up as a race car. It kind of starts its life as a standard road car and then gets made into a race car by Michelotto. So it's got a whole lot more aero. I mean, the engine's the same as the road car.
So usually, in terms of collecting, you usually get those late special ones because they're usually like limited runs and it's like the end of an era, sort of?
Yeah. Tried these. I've had all of those things.
Yeah.
But I mean, Ferrari only you have them if you buy other cars.
Yeah.
So you've kind of got to be a good customer to get them.
Yeah. Well, I think you're one of the best customers. Eh? You're up there.
So you can't just put your hand out and say, "I'll have all the special cars." But I mean, every Ferrari is special anyway. I mean, I've never driven loaded and like driving.
Fair enough.
Pretty basic window configuration. Kind of light in it, but it's got plumbed in fire extinguisher. This has got a passenger seat in it, just, you know, sometimes to take people for rides and those sort of things.
Yeah.
The last time this car raced was at Monza in Italy.
So
Monza is kind of, I don't know, the spiritual home of motorsport for the world.
Yeah.
And fantastic circuit. It was just really high speed and I was pretty, had quite a good week in there. She got a podium.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Nice.
Very last race. Podium in Monza was something pretty cool.
Finish on top.
Yeah.
But like finish your racing career on a good end.
Yeah. It was good, and it was a terrible weekend. It was wet all weekend. Oh, yeah. So it was just, the driving was so difficult and it was so high speed.
Yeah.
I sort of felt lucky to come away with myself and the car in one piece.
Yeah. So is this the GT3 body kit? Like
it's very similar to GT3, but GT3 actually is less horsepower than this. It's maybe like 100 less horsepower.
Oh, yeah.
But this has got less aero on it than a GT3.
Oh, really? Yeah.
So, it's just hasn't got the downforce of a GT3 car. So this will drag a GT3 car off in a straight line, but not through corners.
But it still must have fair bit because it's got the splitters and the big wing. And it's still be,
it's definitely quick.
Yeah.
Much quicker than my car, it's on slips, obviously. Yeah, so see, it's got no rear view mirror, it's just got the TV screen there.
Oh, wow,
Yeah, it's sort of stuff to get used to. And you've got stuff like, it's quite tricky getting in and out of these because of all the caging and stuff. So,
all the wiring exposed and everything.
Yeah, to get in, you can take the steering wheel off.
Oh, wow.
Just clips off.
And then behind you here is the same car that you used to race with, is it?
It's the same. It's the same. So I did three seasons of this, two and a half.
That's a good picture.
Yeah, that's in Malaysia and Sepang, Formula One circuit, so yellow car before this.
And we got the old school here.
Older school car, Ferrari Dino. In reality, it's not called a Ferrari Dino, it's just called a Dino. So Enzo Ferrari's son was named Dino, and apparently he designed the engine in this car, which is a little V6. Back in those days, so this is late 60s, early 70s, Ferrari's built pretty much V12s.
So
they'd be able to play around with other things, but they're known for front engine V12s, not mid-engine V6s. And Enzo's son was an engineer, and he designed the engine, wanted to put it in the car, and Ferrari were quite concerned about, you know, marketing that under the Ferrari brand.
Yeah.
So they called it Dino. But it was a big hit and they sold about 3,000 of them.
Oh, wow.
Which is a big number for Ferrari.
Yeah, so did you buy this one restored?
Yeah, restored.
Nice.
It was restored by DK Engineering.
That's right.
I've dealt with those guys a lot.
Yeah. It's just got that really nice old school lines down it.
It's beautiful design.
Yeah. Looks very comfortable.
It is pretty comfortable. These are what they call Daytona seats. Off the Ferrari Daytona, and it's got the gated gear shift in there. And it's quite cool when you fire it up, like it doesn't want to go when it's cold, it's terrible.
Yeah.
You can't change gear and it sputters. And,
But
you know, you do sort of 15 minutes and it's just really nice and all works together.
Nice.
And it's pretty little by standard today, as car. It's 195 horsepower. So if you say this is a sports car, well, yeah, back in the, you know, say 1970,
oh, yeah,
I think this is a 70 or 71, but around that time, that was a lot of horsepower, right?
So, yeah. And we got the big boy over here.
Yeah, it's a LaFerrari Perra. So, I'm really lucky to get this car. I had the LaFerrari before, so you can see that picture there, the LaFerrari coupe in the background. So that was my, yeah, that was my first LaFerrari, and very few people got both, so I kind of felt I must have been a good boy with Ferrari because they let me have both.
Yeah.
It's kind of a funny system, they let you spend lots of money with them, but yeah, to be on their list is quite difficult, and you know, I've been buying Ferraris, so the first car I bought was 1999, so I've been doing it for 21 years now. And never really knew about cars like this until I bought my Enzo, and all of a sudden they started to be interested in me. You know?
Yeah. So do they, like, because obviously they're not just like on the market, like, I had to ask them if one is available, or do they just let sort of all the collectors know when one is, or how's that work?
You get an invitation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then it's like first person to like say yes, or?
I don't think anyone, no. Anyone's ever turned one down.
Yeah.
Of these types of cars.
But like they just decide who they invite?
They decide who they invite.
So they're like, there's like a few people and they're just like, oh, we'll give it to this guy. Like, we'll invite this guy.
Yeah, they run a system where they rank their customers in order of
how
important these customers are. And I think it's based on lots of things, you know, if you're in the racing program, do social media, you know, like that.
Yeah.
But just, you know, I think the main thing is just being really passionate about cars.
Yeah.
You know? Particularly their brand, and I am, and
have
been for ages, and talking it up, and around that kind of 2012, I started getting invitations to things overseas and stuff.
Yeah.
And when I got the first car, I got just through the dealer here, I said, "Can you be in Italy next week?" And I said, "No." "What for?" He said, "Oh, you should just go." So I did, and it was the launch of that LaFerrari, so no one had seen it at that stage.
Oh, wow.
They take you, show you the car, and you meet the chairman of Ferrari.
Wow.
And I ended up having lunch with them.
Wow.
Yeah, just like him and me and a mate, I took over, and you sit there and talk to those guys, and they decide if, you know, you're the guy they want to have their car. So, so around that time I got that, and then I got this and the TDF. So they were the three heavy cars at that time, I got all three. So, you know, it was by invitation only, and they sent, and this, I'll show you if we go upstairs, they send you this carbon fibre box, and it's got a letter from the chairman of Ferrari,
who
said you were Macchiani at the time, and it's got a key with your name on it.
Wow.
And it's, you know, we like you, you know, would you like to buy this car?
Yeah.
Of course you say yes.
Because they must be, like, they just look way lighter. I think they look way better than the Bugatti's, which kind of like bugs. They look a bit too curvy. This is just, especially the headlights, they're so iconic, they're super. Headlights, how far they are out from the frame.
No one's ever said, oh, I don't think that was
I'm sure.
And you know, even the road test you see compared to like these with the 918 Spider and the McLaren P1 and stuff.
Yeah.
Like I think, you know, the P1 might be a little bit quicker on a track and the,
yeah,
you know, the Porsche might be a little bit more usable, but just in pure grunt, you know, forget them. And I've driven a McLaren P1, so I know what that car's like. I've made them on hell.
I bet this sounds better than the V12.
It's got just one electric motor, and it's in the drivetrain.
So
like Tesla stuff have one on each wheel and that sort of stuff.
But it's just for a little bit of extra torque at the start.
It just fills in the torque gaps, really. So it's just like seamless power.
Yeah.
But plus the engine revs to like 9,000 revs.
Wow.
It's like a proper engine.
Yeah.
I got definitely one of the first cars in the world. It might be the first, I don't know, because they don't tell you.
Yeah.
But this wasn't launched till 2017, which was the 70th anniversary, and I went over to the official launch and all that sort of thing and see a car, and this was the launch colour, and I said, when's my car coming? And they said, oh, I can't talk about it, you know, but I want it. Yeah. And in the end they said, okay, well, your car exists and you can have it, but you can't show anyone. So they send it over here and they fly them over because the batteries get flat on a boat, so it's got to come on a plane.
Yeah.
And I got this in November 16. And it just sat in here, and I wasn't allowed to show it to anyone until March 17.
Wow.
Yeah, so I know it's a very early car, but I don't know.
Is that like in like a contract, or are they just like, you know, obviously if they find out, they'll never sell you? Yeah.
I just do as I'm told.
Yeah.
I'm never going to do anything to cross them. So, yeah. Yeah. Just say that's what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
Jump. say how high.
Yeah, just the shapes on this car are amazing.
It's a special regime when they service these. They've got to like mark it off from the rest of the service area and have things that earth it and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
I think 400 watts in there.
Wow.
And yeah, these are limited. They only made 210 of these.
Yeah.
And so basically you've got to be in the top 210 Ferrari customers to get them.
Yeah.
So I felt pretty privileged.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So this is just a Spider. So I like convertibles. You know, whenever I can get a convertible, I do.
Especially the newer ones, like there's not none of that soft top crap. It's the really nice looking hard tops that automatically come in and out.
It's pretty easy. Yeah. And they always make less of them, so it's a bit more red. This color's triple layer orange. So like in the TDF, it's triple layer yellow. I saw this color. So it's a special color. It's called Carco, and it was named after the guy who developed this paint with Ferrari. So you can go to them and they'll make a paint.
Oh wow.
And name it after you.
Yeah.
But it's for you, right?
Yeah.
They make it. So there's quite a few examples of that. But I saw a LaFerrari in Japan, this color, I thought it was the best looking thing I've ever seen. So I went back through Ferrari and said, look, I've seen this car, you know, how do I get that color? And they said, it's Mr. Carco's color. And I said, would you mind asking for me if I could paint a piece of their color?
Yeah.
And anyway, they did. And yeah, here's the car, he agreed. So
yeah.
I don't know how many cars are painted this colour. There's the only two I know of.
Unless someone also went to Japan, saw that guy's orange LaFerrari and asked Ferrari to do that, they wouldn't have the exact same colour that you do. It's crazy.
That's right, you know, like Orion looks great, and it's kind of, there's definitely not many orange Ferraris around.
Yeah.
And this one kind of went hard out on the extras on this. So got the Italian flag stripe, the painted on shields on it. But I did wonder how that was going to look, sort of bright yellow and bright orange, but that's why we did the calipers yellow and the centre caps yellow.
I think
711 horsepower in these, but it's got, you know, this sort of racing bucket. It's got a manual seat, not electric seats, it's got racing seats. It hasn't got carpets in it, it's got the floor. And it's got a bunch of stuff like, you know, all the little buttons, you control launch control and reverse.
Oh, yeah.
Italian flag stripe, Italian flag shifters.
So. That's all the options.
It's kind of in a way a waste of money buying all these options because you never get your money back when you sell it, but I always like to just make it kind of, I think I've got the best one that's out.
Yeah, well, if you can afford it, why not?
Yeah, that's the Spider. And kind of the last car in here to show you is this 355. So sort of in keeping with just having cars that are perfect, which is what I like to do, I bought this car from Decay Engineering back a couple of years ago. A lot of these date back to sort of mid-2017 because we sold a company then, so I was a bit flush with money, so we spent it all on cars. But this car has done 600 odd kilometres from new.
Wow.
So 355 was kind of, you know, in the day, kind of, I guess, the entry level Ferrari, so a lot of people bought them, they drove them a lot. And they made, I think, something like 3,000 of them, so for Ferrari that's a lot.
Yeah.
But a lot of them have been wrecked.
Yeah.
And even if they're not totally wrecked, you know, they've been had a sort of hard life.
Yeah.
People flogging them. But this one is just sort of mint, and it's one of the last ones built, so it's got a few things that are unique about it. It's like, it's got carbon fibre in a door panel, so it's the only one I've ever seen like that. It's got a high stop light on it from the factory, sills of carbon fibre. But it's got all the things like, you know, still got all the original kind of safety stickers and things on it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's a manual, so it's a gated manual, which is just like the tallest thing. Yeah, and it's just like a brand new car.
Yeah. Pop-up headlights. You've got pop-up headlights,
yeah.
You got to have one pop-up headlight car. You got your man cave, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so, like, those windows out there, they're like one-way glass, so you can see out but you can't see in, which is really cool. And then, you know, you only want people seeing this as if you're allowing them in. But yeah, just like the size of this place, it's amazing. And then he's got like his own little sort of studio up there. And then back here you got your big simulator.
Yeah, so come and have a look at the simulator. It's obviously a lot of Ferrari branding on. It was made by Motion Force, a New Zealand company down the Hawke's Bay. But did a pretty good job of it, and they've kind of Ferrari always did for me.
Yeah.
So it's just a kind of set up, ready to go now. So
huge.
Ben Shortley is going to have a go. Tells me he's very quick.
Yeah. Apparently I'm going to have a lap around Bathurst. We'll see how that goes.
Yeah, so that's, I do spend a bit of time on that, but I mainly got it like back in the day when I was racing, because you
know,
being quite a gentleman racer, you can't practice in the car that much, and you get rusty, and you have
four or six races, to fly to somewhere in the world with your Ferrari, and you know, costs the same, like one trip would cost, what was it cost?
Well, you definitely get much more
benefit in
the car.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, you smack it up, doesn't cost anything.
Yeah, and you can play any car, any track in the world.
So this has got a set of course, iRacing on it, and you can drive on any track in the world. And it's, as you know, it's pretty realistic, right? And you can see down a track, and the mapping, particularly on iRacing, is just so good.
Yeah.
It's like fantastic. Yeah. Every little bump and slippery patch, and you work out what curves to go on and what not.
Because actually, they go to the tracks and they 3D scan all the things, eh? It's pretty interesting.
Yeah, so they absolutely, like if you go around somewhere like Bathurst, I mean, all the little bumps are exactly where they are.
Yeah.
And even considered almost oil stains on the track are in the same place.
Wow.
It's crazy.
I used to play this, we had one at my old house, like, a year ago, and I used to play it a little bit, you know, an hour a day or so, but it's been a while, so I'll probably be pretty rusty. What car am I gonna, are you going to put me in for the Bathurst?
Well, probably a Mustang, I think.
Hey guys, so I just got home from Grant's workshop and realized that I did not film an outro. The SD card in my camera actually completely filled up because we were filming in like 4K the whole time. So yeah, we filled up that 64 gig card in like an hour and a half. But it was a great time, just crazy workshop. I've been there a few times, but last week I asked him if it would be cool if we could do a vlog on my channel just touring around his garage, and he said yes. I do quite a few photo shoots and some content for Grant. We're actually shooting his LaFerrari tomorrow. Incredible collection, very very nice guy, and if you want to see more of his stuff, you know, more of his cars, he does some cool stuff, he's been like drifting in his F12 and stuff, follow him down below, it's Grant K Baker on Instagram. And yeah, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed, subscribe down below, and I will see you in a few days for the next one. Bye.